Before talking about this differential piecewise system, if I ask you that in one organization, if we provide two different type of wage rate to different type of workers, is it justified? Will you support it? Obviously, your answer would be no. But Taylor was of a different opinion, and he's a strongly advocates the piece wage system, where he says that there are two type of workers. One is efficient, another is inefficient. And inefficient and efficient worker, both should not be given the same type of wages. So he suggested two different type of wage rate system for efficient and inefficient worker. See, in a standardization, what we studied, that there should be a standard time to complete a job. In time study, you have seen that we calculated that if a worker is doing, suppose the standard time is 10 hours, and if a worker is doing that much production, means producing 10 units, so he is an average worker. But if he is producing more than that, then we call him efficient worker. And if he is producing less than that, means 9 units, 8 units, then we call him inefficient worker. So in a differential piece wage system, when you have identified the efficient and inefficient worker, now how will you deal with them? So this is the technique which is talking about it. So he wanted to differentiate between these two. This is clear now. The standard time and other parameter should be determined on the basis of work study, which we have discussed before this. You remember time study, motion study and all this. Then the workers can be classified as inefficient and efficient on the basis of the standard which we have formulated or devised. Now he wanted to reward efficient workers, so he introduced a different rate of wage payment system for those who performed above standard and for those who performed below the standard. Okay, now let us take this example. There are three workers. The standard output is 10 units per day. And what he decided, he said that those who made standard or more than standard will get 100 rupees per unit wages, and those below of that will get 80 rupees only per unit. So now an efficient worker, take the example of Ram, standard output is 10. Wages per unit, how much he will get? If he has produced 11 units, means more than the standard, then he will get wages at the rate of 100 rupees per unit. But if you are producing less than the standard, means the standard is 10, and standard is 10, as you have seen here, and you are producing less than that, one unit is less, so you could actually produce 9 units only. So now you will get at the rate of 80 rupees. And Bharat is the standard one. He is the average worker. So he could produce actually 10 units in a day. So now if you have to calculate the wages for them, how it will be calculated? The actual output for Ram is 11 units, and he will get at the rate of rupees 100. So he will get 1100 rupees. And Lakshman, who could not produce the standard output 10 units, he could produce 9 units. So he will get at the lesser rate. So 80 rupees per unit he will get. So in this way, how much he will get? 720 rupees. And Bharat is the standard output he could produce. Actual output is also 10, standard is also 10. So he will get 1000 rupees the wages in a day. Now, if you see the difference between Ram and Lakshman is 2 units only. Lakshman could produce 9 units, Ram could produce 11 units. But if you see the difference of the vases in between them, it is so 2 units less, you are getting 380 rupees less. And even if you compare Lakshman with Bharat, he just have produced 1 unit less. Lesser 1 unit production, but the difference in the wages is 280 rupees. So if you see this, then Taylor believed that the difference between these wages per day will inspire, will motivate other workers to do better work or to produce more. So in this way, the productivity would be more. If you see his own experience, so Taylor gives the example of a worker named Smith, who was able to earn 60% more wages from $1.15 to $1.85 on increasing pig iron loading from 12.5 tons per man to 47 tons. So if you compare this 12.5 to 47 tons, you can easily understand that it is almost 4 times. So he conducted this technique in his own company, Bethlehem Steelworks, as I said while I was discussing the life sketch of Taylor. So this technique will be helping the management in this way. So differential piecewise system, if you follow, there are some benefits, there are some advantages. What are those? The objective behind it or the purpose behind it, following the differential piecewise system, is what? It will motivate less efficient worker to produce more. As you have seen that the difference of the production is just 1 unit, 2 units, but the wages is huge difference. So naturally the factory's performance, the organization performance will improve, as well as the workers' performance also will improve. And definitely it will provide higher job satisfaction also to those who are working more efficiently. So those who are working efficiently will get more wages, and it will motivate to maintain the higher level of productivity. So production, if you want to increase, it is very good to introduce differential piece wage system in the organization. Though this technique was criticized later on because it's ignoring the human aspect and focusing more on productivity. People criticize that human beings are converted into robots, and all those things were talked about, as well as, you know, the super efficient people were also ignored in this. And this was the reason that Taylor was not very successful and in his own company. The people didn't, means the employees of that organization didn't appreciate him much, because he was using more and more their efficiency, their work, to give more production. So human aspect, you can say, was being little bit ignored in it. But if you compare it with the fuel, you will find that it is not so. In fuel, human aspect has been accepted and honored. Now, if we have, after studying all these things, now we can say that it is very important to have a re-look on the techniques and principles what we have discussed till now. So obviously he is in search for one best method, true, and through method study, through other work study, he could achieve that. And the chosen method must lead to the determination of a fair day's work, so that we can easily identify what is the standard time, standard work, and how much we will get work done in a day. So that will obviously help in better planning. There must be good compensation system that differentiate those who are able to accomplish exceed the fair day's work. Fair day's work is your standard time, standard work. So if there is one person who is efficient, he should be rewarded for that. He is talking about that. Then you also said that the differential system must be based on the premise that efficiency is the result of the joint effort of both managers and workers. So again, he is talking here about the harmony principles. No? Then few more thing. If we see all his principles and techniques, so he basically was in favor of harmony in the work to maximize the output rather than restricting the output. So he was not believer of quarreling over the shares in the resultant surplus between workers and managers. So both should have the prosperity in the organization. Clearly, the sum and substance of Taylor's ideas lies not in the disjointed description of principles and techniques, but he referred here as mental revolution. Mental revolution is what? A change in the attitude of workers and management towards each other. So he was in favor of competition to cooperation, and both should realize that they require each other. Both should also aim for increasing the production size of surplus, then only the organization will grow. And he also wanted to eliminate the agitation part from the organization, and management should share if they have some surplus. One of the principle we talked about it. Workers should also contribute more towards the goal of the organization so that the company makes more profit. And this attitude will be good for obviously both management as well as workers. So in the long run, only workers' well-being actually will ensure the prosperity of the business. So they both are dependent on each other, and this is what the scientific management of scientific principles of management talk about. Now, a few more things should be very clear in your mind. After studying all the elements, principles and techniques, now it is very important to see that today so many new techniques have been deployed as a sequel to scientific management. So now in the same series, let us understand that what is operation research. Operation research actually was developed during the Second World War to optimize the deployment of war materials. Assembly line, already I have explained it. Now let us understand that what is lean manufacturing. The term lean manufacturing is basically a production method which was derived from the Toyota's 1930 operating model, the Toyota way. It is popularly known as TPS, Toyota Production System. So in the simple language, we may define it the business of producing goods in large numbers using methods that avoid wastage and reduce the time taken. That is actually called lean manufacturing. It is associated with TPS, Toyota Production System. Nowadays also you see the use of robotics and computer in the production process and enhancing the productivity of the organization. So this is part of scientific management, you know, and it definitely it will increase the productivity levels. Then some of the terms used in modern manufacturing, and these were the applications of scientific management by Taylor. It is given in your book also. So you just go through it. It is not to be studied in too much detail, but at least you should have a reading of it. And in this way, now we finish and complete the principles of scientific management and techniques of scientific management. So finally, we completed the techniques of scientific management. It's functional foremanship, standardization and simplification of work, work study. Work study have four aspect: fatigue study, motion method study, time study, motion study, and then differential piece weight system we discussed. some people believes that mental revolution is also a technique, but your book does not say so. So we have studied this mental revolution, but you will not categorize it into the category of techniques. So techniques, if we have to discuss, we will talk. We say that one is functional foremanship, second is standardization simplification, and third, like this method study, time study, motion study, fatigue study. So then the last one would be differential piece weight system. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So 7 techniques we have completed. The work and contribution of both Fiol and Taylor towards enhancing the quality of management is highly appreciated. When we try to analyze and compare the contribution of both of them, we reach a conclusion that both of them were almost similar in their approach towards certain aspect of management, while contradicted also in each other greatly on some aspects. Like both Fiol and Taylor, through their respective principle, emphasized upon the importance enhancing employees' participation. Fiol suggested the principle of initiative in this regard, whereas Taylor also laid due emphasis on adoption of suggestion system in an organization through the principle of cooperation and not individualism. Having discussed the similarity in their approach, it is also important to bring out the aspect where they contradicted each other, like the principle of unity of command. As suggested by Fiol, advocates that dual subordination should be avoided, whereas through the technique of functional foremanship, Taylor emphasizes on multiple accountability of a worker towards 8 specialists. So moreover, it is also important to appreciate the fact that the technique of functional foremanship as suggested by Taylor is an extension of the first principle of division of work. So if we compare both of them, you will find some contradictions, some similarities also. Now after learning in detail the contribution of two great scientists, the Henry Fiol and F.W. Taylor, I'm sure you can compare the contributions of each of them. It is the contribution of these two great management scientists, Henry Fiol and F.W. Taylor. You must have realized that their contributions are not contradictory, rather they complement each other. While one has revolutionized the working of factory shop or the production place by giving the ways and means to achieve maximum efficiency and productivity, and the other has developed the principles to achieve managerial efficiency. So the contribution of Taylor and Fiol can be summarized as follows. Now we may compare these two, the Henry Fiol and F.W. Taylor. If you see the meaning is very clear. He is the father of modern management who laid down 14 principles of management for improving the overall administration work. And then Taylor is considered as the father of scientific management, who introduced 4 principles and 7 techniques to increase the overall productivity. So here he is about improving the overall administration, and Taylor was to increase the overall productivity. Now if you see the perspective or the levels, you know, where these two were working, Fiol was working at the highest level, top level management, middle level management, and Taylor was have done all the studies at the lowest level in the organization. So Fiol primarily focused on how the top level management should conduct themselves, and Taylor suggested the techniques of functional foremanship. Taylor primarily focused on shop floor level of a factory. Then if we compare on the basis of focus, we can say that Fiol's focus was entirely on the development of principles for a better management. It actually focuses on improving the overall administration of the organization, while Taylor's focus was on eliminating wasteful movements and savings energy of workers. You know, all his techniques are based on this one. It focuses on increasing the productivity. If you now compare it on the basis of the major contribution, Fiol's main contribution was development of those 14 general principles of management, and Taylor's contribution was development of scientific techniques and scientific principles. Now one more different basis we can take, that is, what was the basis of information for Fiol and Taylor? So Fiol's got all these how he developed. So we can say the principle were evolved on the basis of Fiol's personal experience, and the principle was for Taylor, the principle was based on the observation and experimentation made by Taylor. Now if we have to compare on the basis of the personality, we will say that Fiol's developed the personality of a researcher. His personality was of a researcher and practitioner, and Taylor's personality was of a scientist. If you compare it on the basis of the unity of command, we will say that Fiol was a staunch believer of principle of unity of command, and Taylor, he suggested the technique of functional foremanship, which is contradictory to the concept of unity of command. Now if you see on the basis of the expression, so Fiol's techniques are expressed as general theory of administration, and Taylor's scientific management. Applicability, if you see, the applicability of Fiol's principles are universally applicable, but Taylor's principles would be applied in specific situations only. If you talk about the system of waste payment, Fiol talked about sharing of profit with managers, and Taylor talked about the differential piece wage payment system. If you compare on the basis of the scope, you say that Fiol's principles are wide in scope and Taylor's are narrow in scope. If you see the approach, Fiol's approach was top to down, means he talked about the top level management and then the things will come at the lower level of management, and he was reverse. He talked about bottom up approach. The philosophy, the Fiol's philosophy is general theory of administration, and Taylor's is scientific management. This we have talked about. See, we have compared understood the difference between Henry Fayol and F.W. Taylor, but we also discussed the similarities between Taylor and Fayol. So what was the similarities, if we have to talk about that? We may say that Taylor's and Fayol's principles are complementary to each other, because both have some relevance in the business due to some of the reasons. So if you have to talk about the reason number one, the main aim of Taylor's as well as Fayol's principle is maximizing the efficiency. Remember it, maximizing the efficiency. Second, both insist on cooperation between employees and employers, or workers and management. Then third is, they both give more importance to organizational interest over the individual interest. Fourth, they both suggested division of work for specialization. Fifth, the principles of both are used as basis for research in the field of management studies. So they have something common also in them, and then some contradiction was also there. After analyzing each and everything, we'll see that both are needed and they both should be studied to have a better management system in the organization. Thank you.